Hey there, and welcome to episode 8, the Necromunda Table Terrain School Part 1. In this part 1, we're going to be building the foundation of this table. You'll need two 2x4 foot pre-cut panels, and only 5 of these 6 foot 1x2 inch pine boards. Not sure why I had laid out tin, or why I really bought tin. Maybe it's for another table down the line. I just get excited when I can buy lumber. One trick I like to use while measuring things, I'm currently measuring for the length of this side rail, is to measure against the actual material itself. I find that using a measuring tape, measuring the material, measuring the object, while it is a skill that any carpenter should have, does introduce error into the mix. So I just measure against the board that it needs to sit on. I'm using a handsaw here. It is not a very good handsaw. It's missing many teeth. It has been used and abused. I do like these pull saws because they cut on the pull rather than the push. But in this name of speed and accuracy, I'm going to use my chop saw. It's totally doable with a handsaw. I just have the tool, so I'm going to go ahead and use it. So I cut 4 of these longer boards here. Got to trim up these, looks like, by just a little bit. I like to cut things in batches. Each of these two platforms we're building is going to need 2 of these longer stretchers and 3 of these shorter ones. To measure the shorter stretcher that goes in between, I've just put 2 of the long ones on the side, butt that up as tight as it can get, and make the mark. Again, I'm totally skipping the measuring tape phase because all that does in this instance is introduce a opportunity for error. So I go in ahead and cut that on the chop saw. I'm just double checking that it's actually fitting and that the width between them and on the plywood is accurate. I'm happy with that, so I'll go ahead and cut, 6 of those total, so 5 more. Necromunda table, this one's going to be 4x4 feet, and those can be pretty unwieldy to haul around, so we're building 2 2x4 foot panels here. We found that size still fits in a small 4-door sedan, but is not too unfortunate whenever you're trying to build 5, 6, 7 panels. To assemble this, I'm using tight bond wood glue. The stuff is pretty old, pretty viscous. It is just my go-to carpentry wood glue. But because it is old, I'm going to cut it with just a little bit of water, just to help be able to brush it on. Normally, I prefer a squirt bottle for this sort of stuff. I don't have any of that. Think of it as I call it a glue bottle. It's like an old ketchup bottle from a diner. Because I don't have that, I'm just going to brush it on. Laying out the piece next to where it goes allows me to brush both sides at the same time. And then I'm just going to tack it down with the staple gun. The glue is ultimately what holds these boards together. If you don't have a staple gun, that's totally okay. You could use screws, you could use weight, you could use tape. Just hold it down. The staples are just there to let the glue dry and form the actual bond that keeps it all nice and even. I'm using my thumb here to feel the edges of the pieces I'm putting together and then moving it out of the way when the staple goes off. This makes a nice flush surface all the way down and saves us a lot of cleanup later, although in this case we did try to make it a little bit pretty. I put on the long stretcher first, then the 2 outside stretchers. Right there I marked the middle of the 2 long stretchers. Tacked it in place on the sides and on the bottom, and then I'll insert the final piece using those 2 marks on those long stretchers to line it up. I'm not too worried about this thing being perfectly square in the middle. The plywood, I measured it from the Home Depot store, and while not perfect, it was square enough for a table that we're building. So in this case, a few marks are gonna do me just fine for putting in the center stretcher at a 90 degree angle. Next, I'm gonna use a 1/4 inch roundover bit in my router just to make the bottom edges of this thing feel a little bit nicer be able to carry it around without having to worry about major splinters or anything like that. The same effect could be done with hand sandpaper. You could use a rotary sander if you'd like. You could also, on sci-fi boards, I like to put in a 45 degree angle instead of a roundover. It's just a really subtle thing that when I'm building these, even if I'm doing them quick and dirty like this, I like to put in the extra care. Totally not necessary, and again, hand sandpaper can give the same sort of thing. In fact, many people don't like roundovers at all. They'd rather have that more defined rectangular shape. After I give this a route, I'm just going to clean up the burrs, clean up the corners with a sanding pad, but just by hand. I'm not really doing much other than trying to take off any of the major flyaways that occurred from routing, make sure I didn't gouge any of the wood or the wood grain didn't pop out. The boards ended up not being quite true. Like I mentioned, they were pre-cut, and so even though all the boards that I cut were cut to the same length, I decided to just trim it up on the table saw. I'm just taking off, a 64th of an inch of that side, just to make it a little bit more flush. And then I'd swing over to part two. So I already had those pieces cut using the glue and the staple gun to just stick some glue on, tack them in. Use that middle stringer. I think that's pretty simple construction. It hasn't really failed us ever. We have boards that are 5 years old. They've been out and in the shop. They've been taken to conventions, and they're pretty robust things. The last step, which is a bit unnecessary, but something we like to do, is I use some spackle. You can see it there. There's some dry deck spackle. Goes on pink and dries white. This is just covering up the rough edges of the plywood and going to end up giving a much smoother finish once it's all done. This took probably about an hour. You can see that pink slowly fade out. After that, Ben took out the sander, the rotary sander. I think he used 120 grit. When you're looking at sandpaper, 80 grit's pretty tough. 120 is a good look, medium finish grit. 220 is what you want if you really care about the thing, but this is something that will get beat up and could deal with having a little bit of roughness in the beginning. It's always good to mask up, have that PPE on. And he's just giving it a sand. He sanded the edges down, knocked back all that spackle that we piled on, gave the tops a nice little sand to get away of any major burrs or gouges or anything that had come straight from the shop floor. That's pretty much it. The last step that we're going to be doing here is giving it a back paint. You could do this by hand. You could do this with a rattle can of spray paint. We're going to use something that I'm sure everyone has, and that is our painter and our paint booth to get it done pretty quickly. Turn the fans on, the lights on, get that air ready, slap the board up and spray it. In this case, we're just going for, I think this may be what he even had in the gun at the time. It's this dark brown color that we had. Just something to give it a little bit more of a finished look and a little bit more of a professional vibe. And that's it. If you're interested on where this project keeps going, hit that subscribe button. This Necromunda project is probably going to span over 2, 3, maybe even 4 videos. Next time we're going to be tackling some pink foam to start building up some terrain features and things like that. I'm looking forward to it, and I hope you are too. Until then.